In this video, I want to give you a slightly historical perspective on transistor scaling. The first term which comes to our mind when we think about transistor scaling is, of course, Moore's Law, and that is named after Mr. Gordon Moore. Mr. Gordon Moore initially started his career at Shockley Laboratories in Palo Alto. Then he, with seven other people, including Bob Noyes, they formed this other company called Fairchild Semiconductor. Subsequently, he left Fairchild Semiconductor to form Intel. And this is a very famous set of people. They're also known as the treacherous eight, and they are in many ways responsible for the establishment of Silicon Valley as we know it. And Mr. Moore also, as a result of his entrepreneurial pursuits, has done pretty well for himself. But the thing I want to bring out is this article that Mr. Moore wrote in 1965 in Electronic Magazine. And while he was still working at Fairchild Semiconductor. And this was a magazine article. It didn't have too many technical details. But it had this one figure which became famous and is known, often referred as Moore's Law. So at this article was written in 1965, and there were only very few demonstrations of integrated circuits or integrated components on a chip at that particular time. So at what Mr. Moore did was he looked at the limited amount of data he had, and in fact he had only four data points. So it's not a very it's his hypothesis was based on a very limited set of data, and what he saw was this number of components was increasing twice. It was increasing exponentially every year. And in the year of 1965, it has approximately 2 to power 7 components, or it had around 128 components at that particular time. So what he predicted was this trend will continue, and what he predicted in this article was by 1975, you'll have 65,000 components, or you'll have, looking at this graph, what he predicted was assuming this law will continue by 1965, you will 19 sorry 1975, you'll have 2 to power 16, or approximately 65,000 components on one particular chip. And even though it was based on a very limited set of data, it actually turned out to be true, and that's why he became this Moore's Law became very famous. But it was not a very technical article. It didn't tell us how this would happen. In fact, this was a magazine article, and this is another cartoon from this article, which says that soon microprocessor or computers would become commodities. So like you sell notions, or you sell cosmetics, one day you'll have stalls which will be selling computers. And while this may all sound very normal, remember the year this article was remembered was in 1965, which was 20 years before the first personal computer or the first Apple II or Macintosh came along. The person who gave more details on how Moore's Law will progress, or how this transistor scaling will actually happen, was Bob Dennard from IBM, who's also the inventor for the one transistor, one capacitor DRAM. So here's a picture of Bob with a big smile and showing this one transistor and one capacitor DRAM that we saw earlier used inside the iPhone. And he wrote a couple of papers starting with in the year 1972. So he had a paper in the IDM conference in 1972. He also had an article on IDM 73, which gave some details on how these scaling will actually happen. But the article which is most famous and what he's most remembered for, and what is called as Dennard scaling, is this article from State JSSC. Written in 1974. It has over 1200 citation. It's one of the most cited articles from this journals. And what he did in this article was he laid out the rules at by which scaling of transistors will happen. And this is described in this very simple table. So this was the first table in this article. And what it says was, to scale the transistors, what we need to do is scale the oxide thickness of our dielectric by the scaling factor. So then he defined the scaling factor, he calls as K, and he said the nominal value of K, let's assume it's 1.4. And what he says is that we need to scale all our dimension, that is, we need to scale our oxide thickness, we need to scale the length, we need to scale the width of the transistors, each by this factor 1 by k. So if k is 1.4, we need to make each of our lengths to be 1 over 1.4 or 0.7. And he also said we need to reduce the voltage by the same amount, so we need to scale our voltage also by 0.7. And then what he says was, then if we do all these things, our current will actually scale or decrease by 1 over k as well. So let's actually check that assumption. So what he says was, let's scale each of these by 0.7. So we scale W by 0.7, we scale L by 0.7, so this thing remains unchanged. Then he said, let's scale the oxide thickness, so this scales by 0.7, right? Then he says, let's scale all the voltages, that is including the drain voltage, the source voltage, as well as the threshold voltage by 0.7. So if we do that, then we scale this by 0.7 square. And we can see that in fact the current does become 0.7. So that's what he says. If we scale all these dimensions by 0.7, we also scale the voltage by 0.7, then our current will in fact scale by 0.7. And then what he says, the capacitance which is simply given by the capacitance is which is simply given by the area. The gate capacitance, which is essentially simply given by the area by the thickness, is simply proportional to the WL by TOX. And if we scale all of these dimensions, then what he says was, this capacitance will also scale by this factor. So this capacitance, or the gate capacitance, will also become 0.7. And then the transistor delay, which is essentially CV over I. So we have scaled our C by 0.7, we have also scaled our voltage by 0.7 and our current by 0.7. So our delay, which is CV over I, which also the transistor delay will also scale by 0.77, which is a good thing because we will get faster transistors. And then he said our power dissipation per transistor, which is given by V over I, will essentially scale by 0.7 square. So this will in fact become half. So 0.7 square is 0.49, or we can say roughly 0.5. And what he says more importantly was the power density. So everything, all the dimensions have, all the width and the length have scaled by this factor 0.7. So the density of circuits has increased by this WL square. So the density of the circuit has become twice. And at the same time, the power consumption has become half. So what he says, the power density, which is CV over, which is VI over area, will remain the constant because your power dissipation essentially became half, but your area also decreased by half. So this power density would remain the same, or your chips won't become any hotter, neither would they become any cooler. But if you do this, if you scale everything by this factor k, by this factor k, which is 1.4, your power density does not increase. This is also known as constant electric field scaling, because if you look, he scaled the voltage by 0.7. He also scaled the dielectric thickness of our oxide by 0.7. So the electric field through the dielectric, so if we think about the electric field, which is perpendicular, in the perpendicular direction, is given by this voltage we apply on the gate divided by the oxide thickness. So this remained constant. Similarly, if you think about the electric field in this lateral dimension, that's again determined by your drain voltage divided by your gate length, so that also remained constant. So this is also known as constant field scaling, because the fields remain constant.